Hello everyone, we are starting today with one of the very important topic which is usually there in our investment planning examination, and more often I have received these complaints that students forget these equations and they end up losing roughly 8 to 12 marks in examination. These topics are nothing but calculation of risk adjusted performance, that is Sharpe's ratio, Treynor's ratio and Jensen's alpha. Very easy. And I would say these are the cash marks you should not lose in examination. But more often people lose marks here because of lack of understanding of these concepts. So today I'm making an effort to make all of you understand these concepts. Now this is introductory part wherein I'm going to explain these equations undoubtedly, but background of it, like how to derive capital asset pricing model, how to derive capital market line. So these are the things which I'm going to cover up in remaining videos, but this is going to be something very important. If you memorize this thing and go to examination, I'm pretty sure that you will be scoring at least 8 marks in examination. So I hope this is going to be the most fruitful video for you. Okay, let's move further and start with it. This topic is called risk adjusted performance. Now first we'll understand Sharpe's measure, another is Treynor's measure, and last one is Jensen's alpha. Okay, now we start with Sharpe's measure. Sharpe came up, this is the William Sharpe, and who gave us capital asset pricing model, very popularly known as CAPM, and I am also a big fan of him. So this is one of the very important measure which he has given to compare risk and reward. So he gave this equation in 1966, and Sharpe once again is a Nobel laureate, so we should respect him also. Defined this ratio as the reward to variability ratio. Variability is nothing but standard deviation, as we know. But it was soon called Sharpe's ratio in articles that mentioned it. It is defined by, now this is the equation which we should remember. I think it is absolutely very easy equation. You don't have to even memorize, you can understand logically. Now numerator part of this equation, this says expected return on portfolio minus risk free rate. So I define the thing in very interesting manner. Say for example, my return on portfolio is equal to 12%, and during the given time period risk free rate was 6%. Now understand this thoroughly, that to earn 6%, did I assume any risk, say standard deviation or variance? So was there any risk assumed to generate this 6% return? Since it is risk free, risk has to be zero. Getting it? I hope you are very clear with this. So up to 6% return, you assumed no risk. So can we say that you assumed risk to generate additional return? So that is return on portfolio minus risk free rate, that is 12 minus 6 equals to 6. Now you took risk to generate additional 6% return. Now let us compare the return, or we can say risky return, or say risk premium, with the standard deviation, and then we can rank different mutual funds or portfolios, right? That is the intuition behind this particular measure. So once again I say this is expected return on portfolio minus risk free rate. So it says that risk premium, or I can also call it excess return, fine, and this is a unit of this is standard deviation, measure of risk. So this is standard deviation of expected return on portfolio, fine. So I have, say for example, once again 12 minus 6, and say standard deviation for the same has been 10, right? So it is 6 by 10 equals to 0.6. this is the Sharpe's ratio. See, let us don't get into standardizing this ratio, what should be the ideal value of it, say more than one, less than one. It purely depends on the situation of the market. So if market is doing extremely well, so when say market is in a increasing mood, probably this ratio is going to be more than one. But at the same time, when market is falling down or giving very less returns, this ratio might be negative also. It can also be less than one. So let us don't get into standardizing this ratio, but more often this ratio is used to rank the mutual fund performance. And this PPT is equally useful in CA final SFM curriculum. It is equally useful in CS as well as in CMA curriculum, because at all the places I teach the same ratio. It is there also very important. And in our examination, we have got a couple of questions coming up from Sharpe's ratio and Treynor's measure. So it is very, very important. So what happens is, like, I have given three schemes, A, B, C. Now this scheme has, that is our scheme, 0.6 as Sharpe's ratio, another is having 0.8, and last one is having, say, 1.2. So this is ranking 1, 2 and 3. This is what is expected from us in examination. Fairly simple and easy to understand. So I hope you should not lose any of the marks from this topic. So this is Sharpe's measure. Now quickly move further to another measure, that is Treynor's measure. Now who came first, right? Treynor or Sharpe? Technically Treynor came first, but most popular measure is Sharpe's ratio. I am going to highlight that reason. Numerator is going to remain same. This is excess return because Sharpe took the same idea, but denominator assumed by Treynor was beta. Now beta is the measure of systematic risk. Now intuition here is, since you are creating a portfolio, you try to eliminate unsystematic risk. So your portfolio should be having only systematic risk. So he started with this assumption and he derived the measure considering only systematic risk. Once again, methodology is same. I have taken a question later on, so we are going to solve the question using all the measures. But this is the intuition, like, we find out Treynor's ratio using the identical method. What is beta? How it is to be derived? We are going to cover up in separate video. But this is a quick fix thing which we are doing, that everything is given to you and you have to solve the question. Fine. So ranking is the important part which is expected from us. Okay. Another measure which I am going to take up is Jensen's measure. It is also called alpha. Alpha is equal to expected return minus required rate of return. So this has been the standard equation of it, but I understand this thing in a different manner. Now this required rate of return, it was given by Jensen, and this required rate of return is once again based on CAPM given by William Sharpe. Fine. So final equation of alpha is like expected return from the portfolio minus required rate of return. Now CAPM equation is very much known to you, that is RF plus beta into RM minus RF. So now you can plug in all the values and answer is alpha. So first thing you can do is you can rank, or say if you are given individual stock using SML approach, which is also going to be covered up, we can understand that positive alpha indicates undervaluation and negative alpha indicates overvaluation. Don't panic if you are not getting this particular point. I am going to have separate video on technical measures. Fine, but as of now, as I said, this is the quick fix slide. So this is what I expect you to remember, memorize, and you can go ahead. Now in examination, they give alpha, right? And they ask us to calculate like expected return. That is also very much understandable. That means they can give rest of the data, or say they can also create a question wherein they give alpha. I remember one of the question wherein alpha given was negative and students were asked to calculate expected return. So don't worry, you have to remember this equation, and if you remember this equation, you can easily find out missing data. So in this particular session, we have understood Sharpe's measure, Treynor's measure and Jensen's measure. Now this is the example which we have to solve, but this I am going to cover up in our next video. This is extremely important session which is going to be fine. So stay connected. If you have liked this video, don't forget to subscribe it. Thank you so much.